He's having a procedure tomorrow, and he needed some time to rest. So pray for Mr. Larry tomorrow, if you can think of it. Pray for him tomorrow morning. It's pretty serious deal that he's got to go through, so hopefully the doctors will be able to take care of it. Because of his medical problems, he's not allowed to be put to sleep, so he has to go through this procedure wide awake. They can't even put him into twilight, so pray for him. It's a pretty big deal, so just pray for him tomorrow morning, so the doctors will have wisdom and that everything will go smoothly. If you want more details, you can come and talk to me later. I'll give you the details, but just be in prayer for him tomorrow morning as he goes through that. So let's all stand this morning. Thank you for being here. We're going to count some blessings this morning. We're going to sing about it. When upon life's billows you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, count your many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend, help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. You know, it's easy to sing that song. It's not so easy to do. Going through life can be difficult, life can be hard, and you can kind of get surrounded and looking at all of the stuff that's negative in your life. Take a few minutes to just thank God for the blessings that you have in your life, and you will be surprised what God's done for you. You woke up this morning, that's number one. You're on the right side of the grass, thank God for that. You have a roof over your head, you have food in your pantry. Some of you ate pretty good this morning, I can tell. You're looking pretty good. When you start listing the things that God's done for you, you have a vehicle that brought you here this morning. You have a family. You have friends that love you. You have a church that loves you and cares for you. You're not alone in this world. Count the blessings that you have in your life, and it will surprise you what God's done for you. So I love that song. And it helps me remind myself that I need to just, instead of going to God in prayer and asking him for a bunch of stuff, this week I made it a point to go to God in prayer and just thank him for everything in my life. Because we forget to do that. God's not just there like a vending machine for us to go to when we need something. He wants to hear about the good things in our lives too, because he's the one who gives them to us. So it's good to thank God for that stuff. Blessed assurance. Let's continue. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchase of God, born of his Spirit, washed in his blood. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Perfect submission, all is at rest. I in my Savior am happy and blessed, watching and waiting, looking above, filled filled with his goodness, lost in his love. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Thank you. May be seated.
Good morning. Ah, yes. Pop those lights. What? Some of you may be wondering what that's all about. Yesterday, we hosted a back-to-school bash. There were 300 kids and 200 parents, so a total of 500 people came through here in a matter of 2 hours. We were out of school supplies in an hour and a half. I want to thank everyone who worked, everyone who bought school supplies, donated and all. What an incredible blessing it was. We were really made an impact. By the way, all those families that came through, they hit the snow cones and got a gospel witness. They came down our table, they got a gospel witness. They got a backpack, they got a gospel witness. So here's the, it was an incredible opportunity for us to share the gospel. Our vision statement here is we reach the world through building relationships. And we build a relationship between us and God, between each other here in the church, and with the community so that they can meet their God and come part of our church. So we are building relationships, and yesterday we made an impact on about 500 people. So thank you all for all your good help. You have something you need to talk to us about? Okay, come on.
I always have something I need to talk to you about. Very special prayer request, if I may. We service about, on an average, of about 250 families come through our food distribution program every Friday. Some of you bring in bags of groceries every week, and we appreciate that so very much, and every box of macaroni and cheese and every can of green beans mean something, and we use them, but we are going through 3,000 to 4,000 pounds of food a week. You don't have to go shopping very often to realize the cost of food is going up and continues to go up, and the need gets greater and greater. We have a lot of heartache coming through our lines. We have a couple that comes through our line every week. They're living out of their car. You can tell by looking at the car and what they've got in it. They're living, literally, out of their car. We have others that come through. They had one lady come through that her brother committed suicide 3 weeks ago, and she inherited his 4 children. So now she's got 7 children living in her house. And that's just story after story. Carol meets with them. Carol Monroe meets with them first thing, prays with them. She was... I don't know what she was doing on Friday, but everybody that was pulling up to me, because I'm the next one in line, they were crying, and I kept saying, Carol, will you stop? And she's, and even one guy, just he looked like a big old construction worker, just in tears. And I said, sir, you all right? He said, boy, that gal really knows how to pray, you know. But here lies the problem. If you watch the news at all, you'll see that Washington State and Oregon State, both food banks, are empty and closed down. The missionary, our missionary Matt, who picks up our food, who has contact, we've got 2 food banks in the area down in Fort Myers, Harry Chafin Food Bank and the Midwest Food Bank that he deals with, that supplies us with food. When you're going through 3,000 to 4,000 pounds of food a week, we as a church are unable to do that. We'd have to spend literally $8,000-$10,000 a week to supply that amount of food. We don't have the finance for that, neither do you. If you do, please give us a check. We'll be happy to spend it on you, okay? However, both Harry Chafin Food Bank and Midwest Food Bank have given notice to Matthew that things are getting tight and things are getting bad, and there's going to be cuts in the amount of food that we're getting. Please, 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 please pray. Pray every day for those food banks. Now, that might be an unusual request, and I understand that. Pray for those food banks that they will continue to be supplied, because if they are supplied, we get supplied. If they don't get supplied, we don't get supplied. And if we want that ministry to keep going and growing, and like I said, the need gets greater. We get more and more first-timers coming through every week. And the heartache and the stories that we're hearing are just incredible. I've lost my house. I don't know where I'm going to live next month. I just all kinds of stuff that we hear. And these are people that are hurting. And we're just trying. And I tell each one, I say, you know, we never know what we're going to be able to give you, but we figure whatever we give you, you don't have to buy. And that's what it comes down to. It's as basic as that. So please, please keep in your prayers the food banks, because without them, we're not going to be able to survive on that. And there's a real danger there of that happening, because I'm not going to go through the whole system of what the food bank system is, but it's a federal policy and program that works throughout the country. And the food banks around the nation are in trouble, and they are hurting. And we're going to be part of it. So pray for those food banks that the Lord will supply for them or supply for us one way or another. All right? Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Speaking of prayer, a lot of things to pray for. School starting this week. Pray for the kids. Pray for the parents. We have a youth group activity coming up on August 12th. See Pastor Tim. It's going to be fun. I'm glad he's doing that. And then another thing, concession crew. Some of y'all don't know, but we do the concessions for Port Charlotte High School's home football games. And we can use some help. In fact, and so that starts in August. The first game is August 26th. There is a sign-up sheet back there if you're willing to help at the concession stand. There's also a schedule of the games. I think there's five games. One in August, one or two in September, then October, and then November. So, but it gives the parents an opportunity to watch their kids play ball, gives us an opportunity to shine in the community, build some more relationships. And I tell you what, there's certain schools here that really love us. Port Charlotte High, Port Charlotte Middle School, and Neil Armstrong, because we take care of them in a lot of ways. So please be praying about that. And then how y'all doing on your 21 days of prayer and fasting? Everybody asking me, because I've been a little bit, you know, I told him I'm not doing sugar, not doing television, no social media. I keep getting emails. You have 95 notifications. Great. It's just going to be huge when I get back. I don't know if I'll ever go back. I don't know. But it's, let me tell you, there's other things that I'm fasting from, but I hope you're having some of the same things I am. God's showing me things in my life that I need to confess and get rid of. He's showing me how incredible He is, and I pray that you're having those same things. Some things that we need to be praying for: leadership. Let me talk about that as we're talking about leadership. You know, we're having a little bit of growing pains. If you've been around here a little while, you've noticed that we're getting a little bit bigger crowds, and we're getting more kids, and we have a whole bunch of kids that my wife takes care of in children's church. And if they're all here, there's, what, 25 of them from 3 or 4 years old up to third grade. Yes, we cut off at third grade. And we actually need to split that class. So I'm going to just throw it out there. If you're interested in being a blessing to some kids, we have an opportunity to serve in children's church. We're going to split them. You can either work with little ones or bigger ones or whatever. But listen, kids, they're the future. And they respond to the gospel a lot better than old people. So It takes a lot more to convince us, but you can have a great, great blessing there. And if you're willing to help out, see me, see my wife, probably see my wife because she's the one that is doing all that. But I tell you, it's great. What a great problem to have, right? And we can step up in there. Also, we want to pray for missions, expand our global outreach and influence. That being said, real quickly, I want to get y'all's approval. A few weeks ago, we had a guy named Corey here. Some of y'all remember him. He made a knife, gave his story. And what he does is he makes his knives and gives his story as he raises money to send people on mission trips. In fact, in a couple weeks, I'm going to be going to Dominican Republic. I'm going to meet him and some others down there. We're going to finish up that that clinic we've been working on. But as he's getting started in this new ministry, I would love to help him do that by supporting him. I'm going to support him like a missionary for 1 year to help him get started. And do I have anybody that's willing to do that? You guys okay with doing that?
Amen.
Amen? Oh, okay. Anybody don't want to do that? Okay. That's good. Then we'll go ahead and help him for a year out of our missions. And I'm not going to bend down and pick that up. I might not get back up. Continued outreach, church health. We need to meet each other's needs, and we need to take care of each other and be praying for our finances. God is blessing us incredibly. Financially, a few years ago, it was week to week, and you can ask Kim, she does the books, and it was crazy. God has given us a surplus, and we are so grateful for that. When I say surplus, it's enough that we don't have to worry every week if everything's going to happen. That goes to you all. You all are great. What an honor to pastor a congregation that is so active and so giving and so loving. Y'all are amazing. Thank you for that. And God is honoring you and blessing you because of it. So I guess that's enough. I sound like Gretchen up here now. Just not as funny. Okay? But we'll come back and we'll do some praying. But thank you all again. I can't thank you enough for all that's going on. God is seeing it. God is using this church in ways that you can't even imagine. And it's all because we're working together to build some relationships to reach this world.
Let's all stand. We'll continue singing. Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness, I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. Lord, I'll worship your holy name. Lord, I'll worship your holy name.
Let's pray this morning. Lord, I thank you so much that you are great and you are kind to us. Lord, I just thank you so much for the many blessings that you've given to us, Lord. Lord, I pray that you would be with us now. Be with the pastor as he comes and brings the message, Lord. There's so many hurting people out there. Lord, I pray that you would help us to be a blessing in our communities, Lord. Help us to be a lighthouse that we should be in our community. I just pray that you would bless us, keep us safe. I thank you so much for it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. May be seated. Children, you're dismissed.
All right. See, we need some help. Turn your Bibles, if you will, to John chapter 15. This is a month of prayer, right? Prayer and fasting. And, you know, I've discovered my problem is not so much the fasting from the food parts that I'm doing. I'm doing okay with that, except there's times you want to go grab something. Like this morning, I want to go grab some goodies over there, and I got an orange slice instead. Thank you for that, by the way. I'm fasting from television. So instead of going home and flipping through channels, I'm reading books. Great book, man, great book on the fruit of the Spirit, and I'm reading a book on the 10 greatest revivals in history, and God's starting to beat me up a little bit on some of those things, and all this time that was taken away from him, I'm giving back to him, and it's great. But along with that fasting and God speaking to me through his word and showing me in through books and different things, I've got to do a lot more talking to him. So this month we're going to talk about prayer, how it can change our lives. And you're thinking, why are you in John? John 15, why aren't you in Matthew 6 where we're talking about the Lord's Prayer? Why aren't you in Nehemiah talking about that great prayer that Nehemiah does before he does this great task? The reason is that God led me to preach this to you because that's where I was going to go. My plan was to contrast Nehemiah's prayer and the Lord's Prayer, because they're incredible prayers, model prayers, and you guys need to read that. Nehemiah 1, Matthew 6, go read that extra Bible study. If you're fasting from television or social media, that gives you more time, and you can do that. And then read the Lord's Prayer, the real Lord's Prayer, John 17, where Jesus is praying before his time to go to the cross, and how he prays for his disciples, how he prays for us. But God didn't let me do all that, so he wants me to preach this, and he's always right, you know. So let's start in on John 15, starting at verse 1. We'll read through verse 16. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away. And every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered. And men gather them, and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that you bear much fruit, so shall you be my disciples. As the Father hath loved me, so I have loved you. Continue ye in my love. If you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if you do whatsoever I have commanded you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known unto you. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. By the way, there's a lot of asking of the Father in here, so that is what prayer is all about. John R. Rice wrote a big old book about this thick. It says prayer is asking and receiving. I don't know why he wrote a book that thick when his prayer is nothing but asking and receiving. Some people like to talk a lot. Question for you. If you had 15 minutes to sit down and talk face to face with Jesus and you could make one request, what would it be? You don't have to answer out loud because some of y'all are going to show your fleshliness and want money and good looks and all those things. You already got it. Okay. We're moving good. The disciples had that opportunity. Luke 11:1 says this. And it came to pass that as he was praying in a certain place, when he ceased, one of his disciples said unto him, Lord, teach us to pray, as John also taught his disciples. You think about these men, the disciples. They watched their Lord. They walked with him for 3 years. They watched him come apart many times to pray to the Father. They witnessed all of his miracles, the feeding of the 5,000, the raising of the dead, the healing of the lepers. They witnessed all that, and they realized and started to connect that this had a lot to do with his prayer life, that Jesus went to the Father and prayed. There is nothing more vital to our Christian life than prayer. And God wants us to know how to pray. I think the average Christian knows more about his favorite football team or basketball team or TV show than they do about communicating with God. That's just natural for us, isn't it? And we had this feeling that this communicating with God is all about something weird and special and supernatural, and well, it's a little bit of that. But we have some misconceptions about this thing called prayer, this talking to God thing. And first misconception is some people think prayer is a magic wand. That's a superstitious approach. Hey, pray for me and this will happen. I had a little kid at Good News Club. I don't know how she put it. Mafalda, I don't know. Miss Sandy was there, I think, when we were dealing with her. How did she put it? That if we pray that he's like a genie, that God will do what we tell him to do? Yeah. Yeah, he's a magic genie. And when we pray to him, he will give us what we want. Well, that, you know how many, you know, that's a little girl, and she came to know Jesus that year. But the funny thing is I wonder how many adults think that. that he's just a magic genie in a bottle. My wish is your command. Isn't that funny? Oh, maybe he's like a vending machine. That's the one. You put your money in and you push the button and you get whatever you want. And then maybe sometimes it gets stuck and you got to beat on the machine. That's not it. It's not a magic wand. It's not a genie. It's not a machine. Maybe it's a first aid kit. We pray when we're desperate and we only use it in an emergency. Y'all are asking about my foot. My foot is doing great. It's got a pretty cool scar, but it's doing great. Pray for my back. It's not. You know, you when you wear a boot thing and your legs are off and you start, it's a little off. I'm hoping to get that taken care of in this next week before I go to the Dominican Republic. But what, we only pray in emergencies? When it just gets that bad that we have to pray. That's not what prayer's about either. Maybe it's a tug of war. You got to convince God to do something for you. Maybe you're bargaining with him. Okay, God, I will not eat sugar forever if you just grant me this. Or God, I will go to church every time the doors open if you just let me do this. Maybe you just battle back and forth with God. You got to convince him to do it for you. By the way, if you're that person, stop. God is not some cold-hearted king sitting on a throne in heaven waiting to zap you with a lightning bolt. We don't have to beg and plead to get him to listen to us. Some of y'all are this way. You're just motivated by religious duty, motivated by guilt. I got to do this. If I don't do this, then God's going to be mad at me, and I'll just walk around guilty, and I'll be eating worms all day. I got to do that. Not only do I got to do it because I ought to do it, and it's my duty. That's not it. Do you realize how crippling all of those things are? And there's no joy in any of that, is there? That's why you see so many Christians walking around with that miserable look on their face. I get there sometimes too. I'm not miserable because of what God's doing for me. I'm miserable because of what I've done to me. Here's the thing. If we want to have a powerful prayer life, if we want to communicate with God, we got to smash these misconceptions of prayer. So let's, in the next few minutes, let me give you some things that will help. And over the next few weeks, we're going to go through some things that will help us to let prayer change our lives. So as we smash the misconception about prayer, the first thing we need to understand is there's four purposes of prayer. Four purposes. That's all. Just four things. The first one is that prayer is an act of dedication. Prayer is an opportunity to express our devotion and our dependence upon God. Go back to John 15. Look at verse 5. I am the vine and ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit. For without me you can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into fire, and they are burned. Verse 7. If ye abide in me, and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. You know what it is? It's saying, God, I need you. Too many of us think that we can handle it. By the way, that is the greatest lie Satan will give you. I can handle this. First problem is his I. That's what Satan kept saying to God, you know, when he fell, when his pride lifted him up. I will be like the Most High. I will do this. I will do that. I will do that. If you think I can handle it, you can't handle it. I'm a hard-headed, and I had to learn that the hard way. By the way, my father, excuse me, that didn't work well. My father suffered from alcoholism, and it ended up killing him. But you know what it came down to? He always thought he could handle it. I'll never forget when I was dealing with him before I got right with God, and he goes, well, you drink? Yeah, but I'm not in this place you are. I realized I was headed to that place and repented and turned away from it. To the day he died, he could handle it. And he died because of alcoholism. We think we can handle it. I don't need to pray. This is something I can just do it. I didn't need to pray when I was taking that boat trailer off my boat, off the truck. I've jumped on the back of the bumper several times and to do that. And little did I know that that was going to be the time it got me. Listen, one of the largest problems we have with prayer is admitting that we need God's help. Why don't we just get honest with ourselves? Why don't we just admit that we're inadequate and we're helpless? I know that's not popular. But do you know that that's really the truth? We are inadequate. We are helpless. You think you can handle it, but believe it, you end up getting handled. I'm realizing God has blessed me despite my brokenness and my inabilities and everything else. And the more I can depend on Him, the better things are. We need to understand and pray and understand that that's an act of dedication. Prayer is saying, Jesus, I need you. It is a declaration of dependence upon God. And verse 7 gives us an incredible promise. But if we're not connected to the vine, we will lose all power. I remember when I was a kid, and I was watching cartoons. I think it was a Johnny Quest cartoon. Now, I know they've remade all those, but they weren't like when I was a kid. They were better when I was a kid. And I think on this one episode, they were going down into the deep part of the sea, and they were in a diving bell. Y'all know what a diving bell is? The older people will. There's not enough kids in here to understand that. Maybe some of you don't. Instead of manned submersibles and stuff like they have today, you can go down deep and do really cool stuff. They had this big ball with a couple windows on it, and there was a cord that was attached to it, or lines and air hoses and everything else. And they would lower it down into the ocean, and they'd try to look at things in this little out of these little holes. But if that cord broke, or if that air hose snapped, they were dead. Or as they say in New Zealand, deed. I used to watch a New Zealand murder mystery, and I love how they pronounce deed. Listen, we have to be attached to Jesus. We have to abide in Him. Second fact of the four. Prayer is an act of communication. Communication is one of life's biggest challenges. Most problems come from poor communication. And you cannot understand God, you can't understand His will for your life unless you communicate with Him. Oh man, every problem I've ever had in my marriage is because I've been a poor communicator. I just thought she knew exactly what I was saying. And she didn't. By the way, she'd say things to me, and she thought I knew what she was talking about, and I didn't. It happens here when we're trying to do things. I'll try to explain something, and I don't communicate well, or I'll forget to communicate. That's the worst part. When I think you think you said something, and you don't. And then you get all bent out of shape because it didn't happen the way you wanted. Then you find out you were the one that didn't communicate it. It's a terrible, terrible problem we have. And communicating with God is vital. It's vital in every type of relationship. Communicating to your spouse, to your children, to your friends, to your family, to your coworkers. If we don't communicate with each other, things are a mess. But But just think about it. If we're not communicating with God, our Christian life is almost impossible. And by the way, it's hard to communicate with someone unless you have a relationship with them. So let me stop here for just a minute. How you have a relationship with God is by knowing Jesus Christ as your Savior. You see, God understands and knows that ever since Adam, every one of us are born into a sin with a sin nature. We're just messed up, and we can't overcome that. But God, our God loves us, and He provided a way for us to be forgiven. And He did that through sacrificing Jesus. Jesus came from heaven, came to earth, somehow in this miracle became all God, all man, and laid down His life on the cross, shed His blood, was buried, and rose again so that we could have a relationship. We can be restored back to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. We can finally communicate. That line is made back through Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit takes our communications and brings it to the Father. It's an amazing thing when you have a relationship with Christ. Without it, your prayers aren't going very high. John 15:15. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doeth, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, and whatsoever you shall ask of the Father in my name, He may give it to you. Jesus is telling His disciples that we can ask anything because we're friends. You know, I've gone through life. I'm going to be 64 in a couple weeks. And I think about all the people I've known through my life and all the people I could call friends. Think about those high school years. Those kids are about to go into youth group and all those high school things. And if you go to a high school, there's all drama and there's all this stuff. And I think back to my high school. I am not friends with one person that I went to high school with. There's two guys from that era that I'm still friends with. They're brothers, but they didn't go. One went to high school after I did, and the other went to another school. Of all those time, that's the only ones. And I got some friends that I was in the military with, and we, you know, if you're in the serve, you understand that you're close. That you, in fact, what you do most of the time is to take care of your friends. You ask anybody that's been in battle, you're taking care of your buddies. You know what? I don't know any of them anymore. Hadn't heard from them. Can't even find them on Facebook. And of course, now I don't find them anyway because I'm not doing that. I got friends from college. Oh, we have something in common. We went to Bible college. We know Jesus. We serve Jesus. Still connected with many of them. But you know what the connection is? It's Jesus. I'm friends with them because they're friends with Jesus, and Jesus is my best friend. What an honor that is. Have you ever thought about that? I mean, we sometimes get so rigid and we got to do, that we forget the great blessings, the joy that we're forgiven, we're going to be in heaven forever. Jesus calls us our friend, and he could be your best friend. It's not hard. When we realize that we're praying, when we pray that if we don't recognize what that privilege is to talk to God, and that privilege comes because Jesus has called us friends. I got an illustration here about meeting the president. I don't know that I want to talk to any presidents anymore. I'd rather just go talk to Jesus. You see, I don't know, think of the person that could be the most honored person that you would want to talk to. How you would prepare yourself. You'd have just the right questions. You'd be wearing just the right stuff. I don't know, whoever your greatest hero is. But then think about this. We have the privilege. We're invited to meet with the Creator of the universe. we're going straight to the top. God's saying, hey, look, I'm King of Kings, I'm Lord of Lords, and you're my friend, and I want to talk to you. What a privilege. It's to communicate with the Lord of Lords. We have a hard time believing that God's really interested in us, that he cares about us. He cares about your car. He loves my truck. I pulled in this morning. I said, because I left it here last night. Cindy and I went out together, and I pulled in this morning, and I said, look at that truck. That's a beautiful truck. Isn't that a great truck? I said, it's just like me. And she nodded, yes. Old and broken down. I love that. But he cares about your car. He cares about my boat and all the little problems with it. He's trying to tell me something. By the way, I was listening. He cares about our clothes. He plays that we buy for our kids. He cares about the Christmas presents we give. He cares about the sinus headache. God really loves you, and when you understand this, prayer will no longer be a burden to you. He really cares. By the way, I love talking to somebody who cares instead of somebody that doesn't care. And then I really like talking to somebody who can do something about it instead of someone who can't do anything about it. We need to communicate. Number three, prayer is an act of supplication. Philippians 4, 6 and 7 says this, be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Supplication means asking, and the results of your asking will be peace of mind. John 16, 24, hitherto have ye asked nothing in my name. Ask, and ye shall receive, that your joy may be full. Basically, if we ask, Jesus will answer and you'll have joy. Prayer is God's chosen method of meeting our needs. Some people think because God knows everything, why should I ask? By the way, do you treat your kids that way? Now, I know what my kids need. I know what they want. I know what I want to do with them. But I know in the past that there are times that I waited for them to ask me before I do it. Do you ever be like that? See if they really did want it? Maybe God, you ever think God's like that? He wants us to ask. He wants us to ask. It says, ask and you shall receive. Sometimes he may say no because he knows it's bad for you. Sometimes he says, not right now. Make sure you really want it. You ever got something you really thought you really wanted and find out you really didn't want it? Man. I knew when I was... There was a time I thought if we just had a VCR, it would just be wonderful. It wasn't all that wonderful. Needed a DVD player. I got one, but I don't ever use it. I don't know what I need anymore. You know what? Who does? Our Lord. He knows what we need, but maybe we just need to ask. There are some things that God will only do if you ask prayer. James 4:2 says this, ye lust and ye have not, ye kill and desire to have and cannot obtain, ye fight and war, yet ye have not because ye ask not. There's a story about a guy who gets to heaven, and he sees all of these gifts, and his name is on them, and they're just sitting over here. And he never got them because he never asked for them. It's like that illustration we use all the time with salvation. You can't be forgiven until you receive. You got to ask them. That's part of the believing process. If you don't take it, it ain't yours. Ask. Charles Spurgeon said this. By the way, he's a great preacher of old. Baptist preacher. had big beard, smoked cigars until somebody started advertising this is a cigar that Spurgeon smoked, so he quit. Things were different back in those days. Spurgeon said this, God never shuts his storehouses until you shut your mouth. Pretty good wisdom. What you may be lacking in your life right now may simply be because you have never asked. You probably had rather worry or complain or feel sorry for yourself. How's that working? I just don't want to bother God with that. Why not? He wants to be bothered with that. He cares about you. I just don't want to be a burden. You are a burden. You're going to be a worse burden. So you're going to be miserable? God wants you to have joy. Ask him. And if he says no, it's okay. Psalm 145:19. He will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. He also will hear their cry and save them. He will give you your desires. Isn't that really cool? I wanted a wife. I prayed for a wife. I tried to get it my own way. That didn't work. None of them were worth being wives. Nope, it's terrible. So I just quit, and I just started praying. God, well, I want a wife. Boy, he gave me a great one. Better than I can ever imagine. Psalm 37:4, delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Are you delighting yourself in the Lord? Are you having that joy? Are you allowing the Holy Spirit to control your life? By the way, when that happens, your desires will be pure. John 16:24 again, hitherto have you asked nothing in my name. Ask and you shall receive, that your joy may be full. He wants us to be full of joy. When our prayers are answered, God is glorified, and we share with others his glory. Just real quick thought. By the way, when you are abiding in Christ and when you are enjoying your walk with Jesus, those desires that you have will line up with his. Luke 11:11. If a son shall ask bread of any of you that is a father, will you give him a stone? Or if he ask a fish, will he for a fish give him a serpent? Or if he shall ask an egg, will he offer him a scorpion? If ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit unto them that ask him? Unreal. Jesus is so good with these great questions. Like, duh. I don't know, maybe you guys do give your kids scorpions instead of eggs. Or snakes instead of fish. I don't think so. Why would our God, who loves us so much, do that? We need to go to him. Prayer is an act of dedication, an act of communication, act of supplication. And lastly, it's an act of cooperation. Cooperation. I love to see that coo there. This is the exciting part. Prayer is God's program. He's allowing us to team up with him to accomplish his work in this world. These are some of the most amazing verses. Listen to this. John 14:11. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me, or else believe me for the very work's sake. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever he shall ask in my name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. Let me go back to this. The works that I do shall he do also, and greater works than these shall he do. Do you understand that we are going to be able to do greater works than what Jesus did? That's what that verse is telling us. I have a hard time understanding that until you start looking at the big picture, which is what Jesus is doing. Verse 13 and 14, show us our way. We ask in his name, that will I do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And if ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. I love that verse. When I was back in Bible college, I taught what was called the Shepherd's Class. These were mentally and physically challenged kids that come in on the bus. And at one time, the lady that had started was working in that ministry. She gave them lots of red Kool-Aid and cookies and tried to get them to do stuff. Wasn't a good idea. We came in, me and another guy, his name was Curtis, and we started working with these kids, and we started teaching them to memorize verses. This is the first verse we taught them. If you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. How is it possible for us to do miracles more than Jesus? Through prayer. Prayer is not limited by time, or it's not limited by space. It's limitless. When Christ was on earth, he limited himself voluntarily. He became human, and he was limited to one place at a time. Prayers are not limited by time. They are not limited by space. They are not limited in power. People may reject your appeals. They may reject your arguments. They may reject you as a person, but they have no defense against your prayers. Proverbs 21:1, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord. As the rivers of water, he turneth whithersoever he will. Our part in cooperating with God's plan in this world is prayer. We can pray. The most important thing we can do in our Christian life is to pray. Why are we doing 21 days of prayer and fasting? Because prayer is the most important thing we can ever do. You probably don't know that we have prayer opportunities here. Every Tuesday, in that room right over there, three people meet and pray. By the way, they would not mind having more people come pray. And maybe you didn't know, but usually on Sunday mornings before the service, one or two people sit over here and pray for the service. They would not mind having more people come pray for them. I used to go pray with them, and then I felt like, well, should I go pray with them, or should I be out trying to greet people in meeting, and maybe I should go back to praying with them. We come on Wednesday nights, we have a lesson, but a great part of it is prayer. As Dennis reads out the prayer request and the missions and the things that we are to pray about, as he prays, you should be praying. We have prayer. Pray! It's the most important thing we can do. It changes things. Who are the heroes in heaven? The heroes in heaven are the unknown people who prayed for the front men, who prayed for their pastor, those who prayed for the missionaries, those who prayed for the superstars of Christianity. D.L. Moody, an incredible evangelist, said this: every great movement of God can be traced to a single praying, kneeling figure. Do you want to know why our food bank is different than every other food pantry in this county? It's because we have a lady praying with each car. I want our church to be a praying church. A praying church will be a holy church, a committed church, an enthusiastic church. When we pray, we become sensitive to the needs of others. You know, there are people in this church who need a miracle. They need a miracle for health. They need a miracle for marriage. They need a miracle for finances, for jobs. There are people in this church who are hurting. There are people who are not here today. They're maybe watching online that are hurting, and they need us to pray for them. They also may need for us to reach out and say something to them. It's one of the things God's convicted me about during this time. Not reaching out enough to people. A growing praying church is a church that sees God act, and God acts according to prayer. A praying church is a happy church. When we pray and see God answer, our joy is filled. There's nothing more fun than seeing God answer prayer. By the way, If you've been here for the last 5-6 years, you've seen God answer incredible prayers. Some of you are here right now because you are an answer to prayer. Hey, get in on the fun. Start praying. In fact, let's pray right now. Let's bow our heads, please. Fathers, we're here this morning. Thank you for allowing us to communicate with you, to cooperate with you, to bring our requests to you. Oh, Lord, thank you for the relationship with you. Father, may we not just come to you in times of desperation. May we come for you in every time. And may we depend upon you completely for all. Pray now for those who are hurting, those who are struggling with health. Lord, you know every need in here. Lord, especially now I pray if there's one in here who's never trusted you as Savior, does not have a relationship with you, has never been saved. Lord, whatever language we need to do, communicate. Lord, if there's one here who doesn't know you, I pray that even now they will turn away from whatever they've been doing to try to get to you and turn to you, believing in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ for salvation, asking you to forgive them. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand. We still do an old-fashioned thing called an invitation. By the way, I'm reading in that this wasn't always done in churches. During one of the great revivals, I think it was the third greatest, is Finney started this, a guy named Finney, started giving invitations. And we still carry on today that tradition because it's a good thing. You're invited if you want to come to know Christ or you'd like for someone to show you from the Bible, you can come forward and we will, I'll have someone take a Bible and show you and deal with you. If you just want somebody to pray with you, we're here. Or you can stay right where you are. We have some forms in there that talk about whatever your need is. And someone turned in a form last week, and I got to ask forgiveness because I haven't been able to follow up on it yet, but I will. Whatever your need is, we're here to help. Come. Come to Jesus.
Jesus, I surrender all, to Him I freely give. I will ever love and trust Him, in His presence daily live. I surrender all, I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior. I surrender all to Jesus. I surrender humbly at His feet. I bow. Worldly pleasures all forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender all, I surrender all to Thee, my blessed Savior.
All right, just a couple things before we go. Those of you who are here today as guests, we really appreciate you. And I forgot when I was doing announcements to let you know, if you fill out a card to let us know who you are, we'll give you a coffee cup. We love to have a record of who was here. We won't bother you. We will probably send you a note, and you may or may not get a phone call from me. We don't want to be a burden upon you. We want you to feel free. And if you don't want to fill out a card, that's okay too. We want you to just know that we care. And we care enough to give you a coffee cup. That's the one thing I did not fast from. I probably would have been the thing I needed to fast from, right? Because I depend on that so much. Also, please be in prayer this week. So many different things happening. Feed Port Charlotte Middle School tomorrow. Pray for Larry as he's going through this procedure. He can't go under anesthesia, so they're doing a heart cath through his arm, and he's got to be awake through the whole thing. Pray for him. Pray for his wife. This is a very difficult thing for them. And you know what? Let's have fun. Let's have joy. Right. Take it to the Lord. He'll take care of it. Amen? Right. Would you pray for us?
Sure. Lord, I thank you for this day that we've had to be in your house, Lord. I just thank you so much for the message on prayer, Lord, and how it shouldn't be a burden to us, Lord. It's a privilege to go to you and ask you and thank you for things. Lord, I pray that you would be with us now as we go our ways. Lord, I pray that you would be with Larry as he prepares for this surgery tomorrow. I pray that you would give the doctors wisdom, help everything to go smoothly. I just pray that you give him peace and comfort. I pray that you would be with us now as we depart. Lord, give us a good day. And thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen.